We're going to get started, and when our final panelists join, we'll have them come up. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Center for Strategic and International Studies here in Washington, D.C. I'm Jennifer Cook. I direct the Africa program, and I'll be moderating this morning's session. I'd also like to welcome our online viewers. This session is being webcast, and you can follow today's discussion on Twitter at CSIS Africa. And I think during Q&A, we'll take some questions from Twitter as well. This is the second, here are our guests. This is the second event in the CSIS Nigeria Election Forum, in which we profile the voices of leading.
Sorry, ma'am. Sorry.
I'm over.
Okay. Here we go. In which we profile the voices of leading Nigerian political leaders, opinion leaders, civil society members to talk about the challenges in the run-up to the February 2015 national elections in Nigeria. The Ford Foundation generously supports this forum, and we're very grateful to them. Our first session featured Electoral Commissioner Professor Atihiro Jega and a really all-star cast of civil society members examining the role of INEC in organizing orderly, free, and transparent elections. A key takeaway from that session was that getting the technical aspects of the election right, registration, logistics, transparency, is an absolutely critical baseline for successful elections, but that it's not just INEC, it's just not just that technical process, it's not just Professor Jega that will make or break these elections. These forthcoming elections will likely be very hard fought, a great deal at stake, emotions running high, and a deeply worrying security situation in different parts of the country. And at the urging of participants at that first session, we've brought together today leaders from the political parties, legislative, gubernatorial, although I'll explain in a moment, and from the party architecture to come talk to us, and asking them what their role and responsibility is in ensuring that Nigerians have the opportunity to make informed choices and are able to cast their votes in safety and confident that their eventual outcome will reflect the will of the electorate. So we're delighted to have with us today representatives of the two parties. Let me say our roster of guests confirmed as of Saturday has changed quite dramatically as of this morning. Governor Yari understandably has stayed at home after a violent attack in Zamfara over the weekend, and our thoughts are with him and the people of Zamfara. But yesterday and this morning, we've also learned that none of the confirmed PDP representatives will attend because of a caucus meeting that was called over the weekend. You'll see the roster is a little different than your agendas show, but I think we can have a very good discussion nonetheless. We welcome the participants that have come. They include, and I think you have most of their bios with you. First, Alhaji Lai Mohammed, National Publicity Secretary with the APC, the All Progressives Congress. We have Doyin Okupe, Senior Special Assistant for Public Affairs with the government, speaking on behalf of the PDP. We have Senator Babafemi Ojudu, who's Senator from Ekiti State, a member of the APC. We have Babafemi Majemite, Senior Political Advisor to Governor Uduaghan of PDP. And we have Dr. Sanya Awosan, Senior Special Assistant to the President for PDP. Also joining us in the audience is Oma Jebe, a Senior Advisor to Governor Uduaghan as well. And I see that we have Ambassador Adefuye has joined us as well. Welcome, Ambassador. Glad to have you here. So we thought in this session, what we'll do is kind of have a format where I ask a question and we'll give each side 5 minutes to answer. I will turn to Lai Mohammed and to Mr. Okupe to kind of designate who might answer. The guests have received these questions in advance and will alternate between the two delegations. That will take us about probably an hour, a little less than an hour, and then we'll open up for questions and answers. So just to start, and maybe Mr. Mohammed and Mr. Okupe, you can start with this one. We're roughly 10 months out from the elections right now, and I wonder if you can share with us your perspective on the state of preparations, both internally as a party and externally in terms of the national level preparations. And we'll use that kind of as an opening statement. Where are we in this election process? If when you speak, you could press the button here. So why don't we start with Mr. Lai Mohammed.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. Well, at the party level, that's the APC, you'll know that over this weekend, the party started its world congresses all over the country. And next week, Saturday, it would continue with the local government congress. And then on the 23rd of April, there will be state congresses. And by the 24th of May, there will be the national convention. Well, these congresses and convention are coming up now because, as you know, the APC did not become a Abuka party until the 31st of July 2013. And within that time, what the interim executive has done has been to put together the party by embarking on a nationwide registration of its members. And now we are going to congresses and conventions to elect officials and delegates for the party at all levels. Ahead of that, on Thursday, March 6, the party also unveiled its roadmap to a new Nigeria, which detailed the party's priorities in fixing the widespread failings of the previous government since 1999, in order to bring hope and circle to the long-suffering to the people of Nigeria. This manifesto, which we launched on the 6th of March, was prepared after a public opinion survey, perhaps the largest ever carried out in Nigeria, which was contracted by a party with the sole intention of determining areas in which Nigerians will want their government to focus upon. The results were even more revealing than we thought, because in that survey, 50% of Nigerians said things were not going the right direction, as against 24%. Who said things were going in a good direction. That survey also revealed that 60% Nigerians said they want the government to focus more on job creations. And 58% said the president was not doing enough to create jobs. While 59% of that survey said that the president was not doing a good job fighting corruption. This led us to believe that job creation, the fight against corruption, and insecurity are the greatest challenges Nigerians are facing today, among others. Of course, these are some of the issues that will shape the 2015 elections. Concerning our preparations for elections at national level, we believe that not much has been done to engender confidence among the populace that the elections will be different from the previous ones, especially in 2011, in terms of credibility of the process. We believe in the enactment of necessary laws that will make the elections free, fair, and credible. For example, we believe the Independent National Electoral Commission must decide that we would use a method of that we are going to adopt a voting based on the biometric data system, which we believe to be the only antidote to rigging and election manipulation. Also, necessary amendments to electoral law have yet to be carried out, and this is key in ensuring credible polls. Our party also believes there should be a tribunal to summarily try electoral officers and send a message to all that rigging, manipulation, and violence will not be tolerated during this, you know, the coming elections.
Thank you very much, and thank you for sticking within time, which is great. Let's turn to Mr. Okupe with the same question.
Thank you very much, and good morning, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. I have a problem here. The question you ask us is, we are just about 10 months away from the elections, and the state of preparations internally as a party and externally in terms of national level preparations. I have not come here to discuss politics in terms of performance, in terms of what the president is doing, and I don't think that is why the CSI has invited us. Basically, my understanding of this is, as it is usually American, you guys are interested in credible elections. You are interested in free and fair platforms. And it is a fact that in Africa and in Nigeria, we haven't really gotten there yet. We cannot compare any of our elections with what we have done. And I think in order to help the process, that is why you brought us here. We have reservations about discussing our internal affairs abroad, but we honor this invitation because we believe the American people and agencies in America want to help Africa, and in Nigeria in particular. Alhaji Lai Mohammed must restrict himself to the questions that have been asked. He must not, under any circumstances, cast aspersion on the President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, and if he does, then we will change, he knows me, we will change the theme of this discussion, and we will change the mode of this discussion. But for now, I will let it go.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Good. Why don't you tell us what you
I'll go to that now. Yeah, now, in terms of preparation, in Nigeria, really speaking, the organization that is empowered to undertake this is INEC. And we believe that we've got a good man at the helm of affairs. The elections that Alhaji Lai Mohammed discredited, the 2011 elections, was perhaps one of the best elections ever held on Nigerian soil. I remember Johnny Carson commenting on this election. Johnny Carson is a respected person in this society, and I doubt whether the American people will not take his statement credibly. It's not just Johnny Carson. Many foreign observers passed comments and passed that election. There's no election, even elections that were held in the United States had their own issues. We remember the Florida matter, I remember the Nixon issue. So, you know, but by and large, if the average performance is such that it does, you know, the better aspect of it does not affect the essence of the election, usually reasonable men will pass such election as being fair, free and fair.
If I could just say, 800 people did die in the aftermath of that election.
Correct. That was not because of the election. That was because there are desperate people in Nigeria who went and incited unfortunate, citizens to go on a rampage, and that is what happened. That is our problem in the country. It was not the process of the election that killed them. The election took place. It was free and fair. But because some people, here in America, and I've always said it, for an election to be okay, the winner must clearly, fairly emerge, and the loser must accept. If the winner clearly emerges and the loser is a spoiled sport, what can you do about that? This is what we should be discussing here. We all should cooperate and ensure that even though there may be inadequacies in the system, provided the political parties are committed to true democracy. The president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria said it in 2011, that he would rather lose the election and go back to Turkey as a president in Nigeria who lost election than to rig the election. And my mandate here, I saw the president before I came here. What he told me to tell the American people is that he has not decided to run and that he is not desperate for power. And evidence has shown that. Okay. In 2011, just a minute, ma'am, In the 2011 election, the ruling party lost several states, including the entire states, six states in the southwest,
yes. We're going to have time. As we said in the instructions before, we would give each side 5 minutes to
respond. Thank you. That's okay. That's all right.
We'll be able to come back to some of these questions and issues in the question and answer. So we haven't gotten quite a sense of where you think these election preparations stand right now.
The major part of the preparations that need to be done will be done by INEC. As for us, the APC is a very new party. They have problems with a manifesto, world elections. We don't have that kind of problem. This is an established party, deeply rooted, the only party that you find anywhere and everywhere in Nigeria. Well, I'm not coming here to lie to you. This is the truth.
Okay.
We don't have all that kind of problem.
Okay, thank you. As you said, we're not going to cast aspersions.
Correct, thank you.
We'd like to get back to some of the specifics, particularly in the government's role in this. Mr. Mohammed, or Senator Ojudu, can you explain how your party is going to select the best possible candidates to represent you at the elections? How will you ensure that the party primary process is credible, transparent, and democratic?
Thank you very much. Let me start by saying that the world is one single humanity, and whatever affects the people of Nigeria, affects the rest of the world. And I believe today that there is nothing happening in Nigeria that's not known to the world. It's only in those dark ages that you could say whatever is Nigeria should be said to Nigeria. I remember coming here some 20 years ago, again, under this kind of situation. And the concern then was that if there is a problem in Nigeria, it's going to affect virtually all parts of the world. If Nigeria throws out just 5 million refugees, it's going to wipe out the whole of West Africa. And I know quite thousands of Nigeria who are carrying visas or your cards that will allow them to enter into America. So we cannot, be an island on our own. Nigeria's, whatever happened in Nigeria, will affect you as it will affect Nigerians. So let me just say that we need to discuss frankly here today so that the rest of the world will know the same in Nigeria and how to come to our assistance. In terms of how, we are preparing to ensure that the credible candidates do emerge, as he said, some months ago, we carried out registration of our party members. And it was a very credible, very clear and open thing. Everybody queued and were registered into our party. And we have this data is available on our website and everywhere. People can access it. We are having our congresses now. By May, we are going to have a national congress where we are going to elect our leaders, though we have now our interim leaders. And when the time comes, people are going to be called to signify their interest in contesting, you know, for the president, the vice president, governors, and all of that. And again, we are going to invite the rest of the world to come and observe what we are going to do. We are going to ensure that, you know, whoever is interested, we address the Congress of our party. They will address people of our country. They will address the rest of the world. Make their ideology known, make their programs known, and they are going to be asked questions. You know, we don't do politics of bigmanism in our party. People are going to be subjected to questioning. And that was why I, you know, as a senator, you know, had to propose a bill that we should set up a debate commission in our country so that anybody contesting for any public office must be made to go through public debate with his opponents. Because in the past, what we have had is that people are called to come and debate running into election, and they will run away, only for them to come and debate themselves. Have you ever heard where a candidate debates against himself? You know, that has happened in Nigeria. Or called a popular musician to come and ask him questions on national television, and that is considered as a debate. This we intend not to happen, and we are going to call on the rest of the world. For us to have credible leadership in Nigeria, you must ask whoever is going to rule us to be ready to subject himself to be questioned by the people of the country. We are going to set that example in our party, and we expect that when the general election comes, people who are going to contest against our candidate must also be ready to debate our candidate. I mean, the last election in America, even my 10-year-old daughter, you know, I mean, was always in front of the TV watching the debates in America, and he became so informed about the issues involved. Why then shouldn't our own leader be ready to talk to us? Tell us, how are you going to solve the problem of insecurity? How are you going to provide jobs for the unemployed? You probably must have heard about hundreds of thousands of Nigerians who were called to the stadium, now not to any hall to write exam, to the national stadium as if we were going for World Cup, you know, World Cup final. They were called in there to come and undergo tests. More than 20 of them died in the process. That will show you what we are going through, you know, in terms of unemployment. People are going to be asked questions about that. What are you going to do to provide jobs for our school leavers? What are you going to do to ensure that people are not being killed every day? Just yesterday, 120 Nigerians were killed in Zamfara. Every day you continue to read stories about Nigeria, people being killed. It is not Afghanistan, for God's sake. This is Nigeria. Problem of insecurity, unemployment, corruption. You keep hearing of $20 billion missing, 39 billion naira missing everywhere. We are going to ask questions about those things. So, as we move on to the elections, you must insist that there is openness, there is transparency. People must, you know, be ready to subject themselves to be questioned and being examined so that the right leaders could be chosen in Nigeria. Thank you very much.
I think the idea of a national presidential debate is an excellent one. We'd be happy to host it here at CSIS, too. Although I don't know if I'm going to moderate that. So, to the PDP, and I'll ask Mr. Okupe to designate, explain how your party will select the best possible candidates to represent, and how you ensure that the primary process is transparent and credible.
Jennifer, Fred is going to take this question, but we have to turn this discussion away from the conversation of the deaf. Is that people or the blind? This question you asked the distinguished senator was, how is his party preparing for primaries? How that went into and cascaded into also, you know, we must change this discussion. Well, otherwise, it will become a conversation of the deaf. I also can pretend to be deaf.
Well,
I'm not deaf.
Let me just say,
so let Fred take the question.
Well, let me respond a bit, because I think you may have missed the introduction in this. This is really to get the two parties to tell not what the other party is doing, what the failures are, but what they're doing in terms of preparing. What is your personal role and what is your party's role ensuring that these elections are transparent, free, credible, and peaceful? And I think, you know, the idea of having a candidate's debate in the primary and follow on was his response. That's the APC strategy.
The APC,
what is the PDP
the APC
strategy?
Has antecedents. None of the antecedents has ever debated anything anywhere in Nigeria.
I'd like you to answer.
Please,
for the
go ahead.
PDP.
Good morning. I think as a party, the PDP has an established democracy within the party. We have a constitution, and we're not new. except for the APC. You know that in recent times where we've had elections. And one thing we know that we don't impose candidates. We're talking about issues, like you rightly mentioned, issues. So our party, because we have a constitution, we have already an established rule of coming out with a credible candidate. And even what happened recently in the state. So, and we don't have a problem with coming out with an incredible candidate for our elections. But again, like my leader rightly said, we're talking about how our elections can be free and fair, and how the America can come to assist us. That we're talking about here. And the distinguished senator, when he started talking about 20 billion, 40 billion, we all know, because back home, even the figures that are not even established. In one breath is 10 billion, same breath is 20 billion. So I don't expect him to say so because he's in the Senate. He knows what is happening. So back home as a party, we are putting everything in place because we're not new to it already. Because only recently, like I said, even in Delta State, we had the by-elections. And the process was very transparent, very, very transparent. I was even an aspirant in that elections. So the party, those who were interested, came out with their issues, what they think that they can do for the party, they can do for the people, they can do for Nigeria as a whole. Once they are convinced, the electorates, I'm talking about the delegates, once they are convinced to start with, then you come out. Then anybody who has an opposite view can also come out. And the issue of debates is not new to us. We'll be having debates in our elections. So I don't know why the distribution is saying that no debates. We'll be having debates, except that maybe he wants to make it a law now. Otherwise, because for you to bring yourself for an election, you must be able to face the audience, tell those who you are going to represent what you think you can do for them, and also do as a party. So I can assure you that for us as a PDP, we don't have any problem. We already have established democracy. We already have a constitution which we are following. The APC, they are just coming. You can't, Lai Mohammed just said that they are holding our Congress, so they lost. So let them come up with their convention. It's only then we know whether the APC will even start or not. Thank you very much.
Okay, back to our APC colleagues. What needs to happen? What are the priority things that need to happen to ensure a credible election process in Nigeria? And what can your party do to strengthen that process?
Thank you very much. I think this is one of the most crucial questions. You know, based on our nation's history of electoral failures, my party, the APC, believes things must be done differently in 2015. If Nigeria must return to the path of free and fair elections. Therefore, let me quickly race through the following recommendations that my party believes will ensure a credible election process. The first is a biometric voters registration system. This will ensure that every voter's thumbprint is verified and matched with his or her picture to prevent multiple voting or illegal thumbprinting of ballot. Two, demilitarization of elections. Massive deployment of troops and policemen is only aimed at intimidating voters. Demilitarizing elections will also reduce violence. Three, ballot paper. This should be designed in such a way as not to confuse the voters. Also, parties that have no candidates in the election should not be included on the ballot. D, role of the media. The media must be more scientific in reporting election results and must not speculate on results where no exit polls have been done. E, role of international observers. International observers must deploy beyond the urban areas to countryside where elections are traditionally rigged by the party, by any party, as well as perceived opposition strongholds to observe elections. They must not be too quick to pronounce elections free and fair when all the details are not in. F, role of the international community. International community must let the ruling government know that it is not just the outcome of an election, but the credibility of the entire process that determines a free, fair, and credible election. They must be unequivocal that they would not support any outcome of a flawed electoral process. G, voter education. Parties must educate their members and supporters on the entire electoral process and also urge them to eschew violence, which has marred most elections. However, a lot depends on INEC, which must carry out a physical audit and identification of the polling units ahead of the election. Usually, there are hidden polling units known only to the ruling party. Ahead of any election, leadership of political parties with candidates in the election should meet with the electoral umpire, and they should jointly undertake a tour of polling units. Also, there should be no creation of additional polling units a few days before election. H, role of civil society. As I said earlier, civil society has a role to play in educating the electorate. Civil society organizations, to a large extent, have been pocketed by the government in power, which usually coerces them to do the government's bidding by such measures as denying them grants or even accreditation. I, role of politicians. Politicians, perhaps more than any other stakeholders, have a role to play in ensuring the sanctity of our elections. Since they are the major players, their conducts and personal comportment will go a long way in paving the way for peaceful and credible elections. They must churn the do-or-die politics that has characterized elections since 1999. Looking ahead to 2015, politicians should not try to regionalize or ethnicize elections, as is being done today. They must not use the platform of the church or the mosque to canvass for votes. Also, it is wrong to coerce endorsements from religious leaders by subterfuge. A situation in which our president has been going from one church to another to make pronouncements on policies and issues is not good enough and must stop forthwith. J, opinion polls. In Nigeria, recently, we've been witnessing all sorts of opinion polls that tend to distort the true situation of things. Considering the capacity to influence minds, these polls must be regulated to ferret out the charlatans who are engaged in deceit. K, based on our experience at the election that was recently conducted by INEC in Delta State and in Anambra State, it is important to address the issues of credible voters' register, access for voters to cast their votes, deliberate starving of perceived opposition strongholds of voting materials, late deliveries of voting materials, late arrival of election personnel, and accreditation of political parties agents. Thank you.
Okay. Would you like to designate someone to answer from a similar?
Yeah. No, these I'll take.
Okay.
We have to come from a very practical perspective. The body that is empowered to conduct elections in Nigeria has already announced that it will be impossible for them to use biometrics. And if we are talking 10 months to the election, it is preposterous. It's not practicable for anybody to insist. That is the basis by which the antecedents of APC put boo-boo traps on the way of elections. So when they lose the election, they will say because biometrics was not used. Biometrics or no biometrics, nobody is going to be specially favored. So let us get that, you know, and let APC know that from now. So that, you know, when elections are won and lost, nobody will say it is because they didn't use biometrics, that's why we lost. Now, I'm a politician, I'm a practical politician, and I've been in this business for 35 years. I've contested elections myself. I've won some, I've lost some. I know what goes on at the polling booth. I know what, you know, these are practical things that we must do. One, in Nigeria, people are called out to come and, be accredited in the morning between 8 and 12. You go there, they check your voters' things, and you're accredited, you go away, or you stay if you wish. Then at 12 o'clock or so, you come, everybody lines up, and then cast your vote and all that. That is cumbersome, and it's totally unnecessary. From our perspective, I think, once polling op- like it's done elsewhere in the world. If a man presents himself with his voter's card and is, you know, is identified as a bona fide voter, he's accredited and he votes and he goes away if he wishes, or stays if he wants. That's one. Number two, or even before then, sorry, the most critical part of the election, the most crucial part of the election, and the most contentious part of the election is the voter's register. We cannot spare enough time to ensure that we get it right. And for that, APC, PDP, we must work together. We got to work together and help INEC, not distance INEC and say it is their job. Let us hold a meeting with INEC. This is essential to any successful election. You've got to have a list of those who are qualified to vote. And it should be agreed upon by both parties. So if we got to do it 2 months before the election, so be it. So that if there are arguments, if there are issues, we can resolve it. So that we can avoid what happened, you know, in Anambra State, where there are two types of voters registered. Some say this is the new one, some say that's the old one. My name is here, my name is not there. You know, I'm being honest, I'm being very, very, very sincere here. We're going to win this election, but we want it to be really, really very clean so that nobody is coming to say because they lost, it's because the system was faulty. No, we are more desperate to ensure that the preparation and the execution of the electoral process is transparent. If it were even possible, we would have even franchised this to foreigners to come and do, but for our national sovereignty and integrity. Now, you know, the voters register is so crucial. We must do that. We must get that done properly. And we can work with INEC. We can, you know, both of us can work with INEC and ensure that this is done properly. Once we get that platform, that is the foundation of the election, then we then go to what happens on election day, which I told you about accreditation and voting. Number three, votes must be counted at the polling booths. There's a silly law in Nigeria that says that you cannot announce elections at the polling booth. That is fraudulent. It is not right. Once we vote and voting ends, the counting should be done at each polling booth in the Federation, about 270,000 of them, simultaneously. There's technology now. It's not a big deal. We do an election, you go for 3 days for a result. It's not necessary. You send this thing through your iPad, your phone, and everything is created somewhere. But everywhere voting takes place, let the results of the election be announced there and then. Having done that, I believe that party agents should be empowered and allowed to make a recording of the process of counting and the announcing of votes. So, you know, we reduce area of disagreement completely. Because every voting is local. There's no need to come to Abuja to come and hear any results. It's not necessary. In my polling booth, 560 people are registered voters, 350 turned up for election. You know, this is the number of people who have voted, and we count it, we announce it. My agent, my party agent, records it on camera, iPad, telephone, camera, whatever. So there's a record in every polling booth. This can easily be, you can easily come back to it, and if there are disagreements. Okay. No, I've not finished. There must be very serious, very, very serious sanction for electoral malpractices. I'm looking at, like, you go to jail for 21 years. Because, you know, we cannot move in this country unless we have credible elections. And those who want to stop credible elections should be removed from our societies and put behind bars permanently, if possible. So, you know, there has to be very serious, you know, Senator, you know, you guys must go back, make laws that will ensure that you and anybody and whosoever will disturb this election, we go to jail permanently. And you know, when people know that you are serious about this, nobody wants to go to jail for anybody. The last point is this. In Nigeria, I know for a fact, I've told you, I've done this for 35 years, I know for a fact that people vote in one place. While they are voting, somebody is standing, and this is the voter's card. You know, APC is here. Sorry, PDP is also there. And I press PDP or APC, and I just shook somebody very quietly. He's seen it, he does this. The moment I drop my voter's card, I go somewhere not too far away, collect 1,000 naira or 2,000 naira. Anybody found giving money in, you know, at least 1 kilometer radius of any polling station should be taken as committing an electoral fraud and should be jailed also. Should be jailed also. So we remove money, we remove thuggery, we put transparency, and Nigeria will be on its path to greatness. Thank you.
Thank you. Just to follow up, why is the Electoral Offenses Act taking not yet passed? What is the party position on the electoral? And then I'll turn to
Let me first of all, before going to that, commend my this president's spokesperson for his candor on the Anambra election. I mean, I'm so happy to hear today
it goes both ways.
That he's agreeing that election, that election is flawed. It's good to hear from him today. And I also like to commend him, you know, for his calling here for penalties for electoral offenders. And I believe that between now and then, and the election, the president will vote more money for us to build jails, that we take in a lot of those people from his party who have been known to do all of that. Now, let me say this. Members of people from my own party, the APC, we have come up with several proposed laws in the Senate, in the House of Reps, to tackle some of these problems. But because we are in the minority, the majority have always ensured that that never, you know, passed into law. I give an example of a simple law, very simple one, that look, let us have a law that will compel everyone who wants to go for public office to, you know, engage in debate. Again, it has only passed the first reading. Every effort we have made to ensure that this law is passed has been, you know, rebuffed by the majority in the Senate and in the House of Reps, constituted by the PDP. Even this, a simple law that calls on the president to come and address us once in a year on the state of the nation, has been rebuffed too. In America here, everybody in the world wait patiently for the president to address the nation once every year. How do you intend to rule a country that you are not ready to tell the state of the nation? That is still waiting. So even this law about jailing offenders is already there, proposed by members of the opposition. Yet they have refused. The leadership of the Senate, which is composed by PDP, has, you know, refused to allow this to be passed. So that is that. On the issue of our preparation, we have told them, look, 60% of Nigerian population is made up of young people. We are already mobilizing them. Majority of them are unemployed. We've told them, this is about you. It's about your future. Don't just sit down on Twitter and on Facebook lamenting your state. Go out, organize, mobilize, and be ready for this election. In my locality, in the Ekiti where I come from, election is coming in June. We are mobilizing the young men, the young women. We've told them, look, we are going to go and equip yourself with internet-enabled telephones. Record every moment of the election. We are going to enable some also with a secret pen. We have five, you know, persons deployed to each polling unit with, you know, with a camera pen and phone. Record every moment of it. We have done it in the past. In 2007, we went for election there. It was rigged. We went to court. The court said we should go back to court. We went to court again. And at that time, too, in that locality, we deployed secret cameras. And when we went to court, we downloaded a lot of these things and gave them as evidence. That was how they took that stolen mandate from PDP and gave it to us. We are deploying that at national level. And I should not be saying this here, but I think I need to alert the spokesperson of the president to know that, look, we are not going to allow them a space this time around. This election is very crucial for Nigeria. It's a make or break election, the 2015 election. I dare to say that, look, if we fail this time around, we may not be back to discuss Nigeria.
Why?
Because Nigerians are waiting bitterly for what the outcome of this election is going to be. Nigeria of 5 years ago is not Nigeria of today. There are crises all over. Security, insecurity problem, okay. Problem of, you know, of economy, and all manners of problem. Corruption is now gone beyond what we used to know in Nigeria.
Okay.
So,
Senator. Okay. Mr. Okupe,
yes,
the electoral law, the electoral fences law, how, why is it not yet passed? Why is this a partisan issue?
Jennifer, should I pretend to be deaf and just answer the senator? Or should I answer your question? What
no,
do you want?
Answer the question. Answer the electoral question. Law, let's focus on it.
I love you. I'll just answer your question. I will not answer the senator's question. Well, you know, I expected the senator, the distinguished senator, to talk more seriously about this. You know, this is not it's not home video. I mean, we are talking seriously. You know, it is directly in his purview. They are the lawmakers. I only watch from the outside. And, you know, if there are intricate problems and issues, you know, I will expect him in the spirit of our current discussion here to enlighten us and to enlighten the Nigerian public. But what I can assure you that I do, what I say here, I do not speak alone. I speak with the force of the Nigerian government. And we control the Senate, like as he said, and you know, what I've said here, we will ensure that everything will be done. You know, you had the threat he's talking about.
Wait,
that
can I ask, are you saying the opposition is blocking the passage of the Electoral Act?
No, no, I've not said so. I'm saying that whether the opposition, they have no capacity to block anything in the Senate.
Okay.
They don't have the capacity.
Why has the electoral?
I cannot honestly and sincerely answer you truthfully before this distinguished audience, and
does,
I will not lie to you.
Does the PDP have a position on the electoral fence?
It is in our interest that this law is passed. You know, just like the PIB law.
Well, thank you for that.
You know, it is our interest that this law is passed, and I'm telling you that it will be passed before the election. Because we do not want any crying mantis when we win this election. We don't want people to say it was because of faulty this and faulty that. We are going to do everything. You know, this president is committed to free and fair election. How many presidents will preside, you know, haven't won the election, will now preside over other elections in other states and willingly lose such elections? We lost election in Edo State to APC.
Okay.
We lost election in Edo State to APC.
Question, yeah.
We lost election in Anambra State.
Yes.
In Lagos State, where the state lost many local governments, where the electoral officers announced the results of elections on television, the Lagos State government, under the leadership of the APC, stamped it out and said the candidates can go to hell.
Okay.
These are the people coming to the National Secretariat.
Mr. Coupe, okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry.
The APC has no record of ability to conduct free or fair election anywhere in its history.
Okay. So what we got is that you are fully behind the passage of the election.
100%.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay.
I must thank him for that.
Okay. Okay.
You have a problem here.
Yeah. Okay, back to the APC. Do you have a codified code of conduct for the election? And what standards of conduct, whether in speech, action, will be put in place for election candidates and party affiliates? And how will you enforce them?
Okay. Well, again, that takes us back to the reform of the electoral law. All of these things we are talking about, even the law on campaign financing, they are all contained in that proposed law. We've called and we've appealed, we've protested, there's nothing we have not done. Before we go into this election, let this law be passed. Again, as he has admitted, they are in the majority in the parliament. You know, we can only have our say. Why they have their way? Asking them to pass this law, for them, is like committing suicide. So, and I don't see them easily committing suicide.
Okay.
But again, you must not leave us only to it. The world must continue to press them to behave like the rest of the civilized world.
Okay,
let there be laws that will guide our elections.
Okay. What does your party, in terms of a code of conduct, in terms of rhetoric, in terms of discipline, party discipline, what does the APC Does it have a codified code of conduct?
Of course.
And how will you enforce it?
Of course, that he has mentioned part of that. We have spoken to all our party cadres.
Is it written?
Oh, well, it's contained in our code of ethics. We've just launched the code of ethics, you know, that look, on no account, choose anybody bring religion, for example, to the issue of electoral campaign. On no account must anybody be seen giving money out to anybody, you know, in the course of voting. On no account must anybody engage in any act of violence. All of these are stated in our code of ethics that will govern our election and our government, and this we launched in Abuja less than 2 months ago. They are aware. We are asking them to come up with their own so that we can match codes for code and ensure that Nigeria behaves like a civilized nation. We've done that, and it's a challenge to them. They should either adopt ours or come up with their own.
And just a follow-up. If a party affiliate violates that code of conduct, how will they be held to account? If a party affiliate violates that code of conduct.
No, if it's a member of the party.
Yeah. If you could.
If a member of our party violates our code of conduct.
Or a candidate of your party.
No, if a candidate does, he gets disqualified. Small fact, I don't know whether you read our guideline even to the Congress. Yeah. We said that anywhere where there's any violence and can be traced to anybody, that fellow stands disqualified from contesting on our platform for any, you know, for any other post.
Same question to you. Do you have a codified code of conduct? Is it written? And how will those who violate it be held to account?
I am amused when APC, a party that is yet to be really truly formed and be on the ground, is advising a party that is 15 years old, that has existed for 15 years, and that has entrenched party ideas, party ideology, party policy, and it is self-evident. You know, it's the only party in Nigeria that has not changed its name, changed its logo, you know, changed nothing. You know, it has been consistent. You know, we are happy that you are documenting your own policies and all that, so that at least we have a very reasonable and fair competition. We have code of conduct, we have code of ethics, we have constitution, we have policies, we have manifestos that are tested.
And how are those who violate them held to account?
Jennifer, if we do not have a code of ethics and conduct, how will Oshimole, Governor Oshimole, be sitting as a governor, elected governor of Edo State? We contested that election. That state belongs to the, you know, I mean that state, you know, we have the chairman of our BOT coming from that state. It was a monumental disgrace to us that we lost that election. We used everything that we had, everything that, you know, every restraint to ensure that democracy thrives in Nigeria. You know, we have, you know, for us, it is a non-issue. You know, it is great that, you know, an upcoming party like APC is imbibing that, and we are happy for that. At least then we are, you know, we're probably going to end up on the same page. It is already documented, it is in practice, it is entrenched. You know, there's no doubt about it. It is also practiced.
Okay. Can you imagine either side writing a joint code of conduct on violence, on regionalization?
We've got to get there. We should get there. That would be good. That would be great. I'll endorse that.
Campaign spending. Let them also talk about that.
A basic code of principles on rhetoric, on anti-violence, on non-religion, not bringing religion into it or ethnicization.
I think if the Nigerian elites are serious at all, these are things that we must do. It's important. You know, we must do it, and I, we are prepared to spearhead that if they're willing to cooperate. And I don't see why they should not cooperate, because at least they have hope and aspiration to win. It's only when they lose that they will not turn everything upside down.
Ask Lai Mohammed the same question. Would you envision a joint code of conduct between APC and PDP?
We're committed.
You're committed as well. So we'll look forward to seeing that. Okay, let me move on, because I do want to open up for questions and answers, but this is my final question, although I do have one more for you, Dr. Okupe. If you lose the election, on what basis would you contest the outcome, and how would you do it? After the 2011 elections, as I said, 800 Nigerian citizens lost their lives in post-election violence. So win or lose, if the results are disputed and violence seems imminent, what will you personally and the party more broadly do to ease tensions?
Well, I have no problem taking on that question, but I think you've omitted another question, which is, what will you do to promote an election campaign?
Well, I
based
thought because we're
okay.
Running a bit late.
Yes. Okay, thank you. No. Election is a process which only culminates in voting on election day. Once the process meets international best practices in elections, once the integrity of the process is not compromised by do or die politicians, once the military and other security agencies are not used to intimidate the opposition and its members and supporters, once the election is based on the biometric voting system that eliminates multiple or illegal voting, we don't have any problem accepting the outcome. But where that is not done, and the election follows the same patterns that we have witnessed in recent years, then no one will accept the outcome. And of course, our party will not accept such an outcome. We have a record of challenging flawed elections in court instead of resorting to self-help. That probably explains why we also have a history of achieving some successes at election tribunals. But let me warn, even the court option today has been shut out by those who are bent on evolving a one-party state, those who are allergic to free and fair elections. This is because the Constitution has now been amended, and it gives only 180 days for anybody who has any problem with an election to conclude the case. Our experience in 2011 is that most cases were knocked out on the grounds that they had exceeded the 180 days, maximum 180 days. And this is very worrying. Now, we will accept the outcome of any election which is free and fair, but we'll challenge in court any election that is not a process of a free and fair election. Thank you.
Thank you. I think Dr. Awosan will take that from the PDP side.
Well, thank you very much. Most of the things that Elijah Lai Mohammed and my friend Femi has enumerated here are mere superstructures. And the superstructures cannot behave differently from the foundation. You see, what the problem we have in Nigeria, one of the major problems we have in Nigeria, is the inability of the opposition to submit itself to salient civic virtues of responsibility, patriotism. These are important ingredients in political engineering. You will agree with me that the last election, the 2011 election that was adjourned to be free and fair, even before the conclusion of that election, members of opposition began to make inflammatory statements. Nigeria will remain ungovernable. This election will be counted on the blood of innocent citizens. At the end of the day, we are all witness to what happened after the election. A lot of innocent lives were lost as a result of irresponsibility of the leadership of the opposition. Nigeria is greater than individual. Nigeria is greater than PDP. Nigeria is greater than APC. Until the political class, particularly the opposition, come to a level of understanding that whatever happens, even if I am injured as an individual, the institutions that hold the pillars of Nigeria must be defended, will continue to have problems. Already, bubble traps have already been laid. The one that Elijah Mohammed mentioned there, that we have to use machine. What is important is for us to agree that come rain, come sunshine, we will defend the integrity of Nigeria. We will defend the sovereignty of Nigeria. When the opposition loses the election is not free and fair. Any day they win the election is free and fair. When the court gives judgment against them, Nigeria judiciary has been bought over. Nigeria judiciary is irresponsible. You will agree with me that there were controversies surrounding the judgment of the appeal court when Justice Ayo Salami was there. I don't want to watch our dirty linen in the public. But such occurrences, they are true, they are in order as long as it's favor the opposition.
Okay.
For us as a party, we believe in ensuring that ethics are properly followed.
Okay.
Unlike the APC,
okay,
they said,
no.
Sorry, last point. The standard that the APC said they maintained was the same standard they maintained during their party decision in Ogun State.
Okay.
That a lot of people lost their lives. Party leaders within their own party were harassed. Eminent personality like Osebu Oshoba was nearly kidnapped. I mean, so those are not.
We asked you to speak to the PDP room. Okay, I'm going to ask a final question because to Mr. Okupe, who works with the government, and so has the government has a particular role in this and a leadership role in setting a model of conduct. So, what can the government and you in your position do to promote a civil political discourse during the election period?
Thank you very much, Jennifer. I think at moments like this, God deliberately puts people who, you know, will do things right. We're lucky at this point to have a man at the helm of affairs in the person of President Goodluck Ebele Jonathan. A man that is already satisfied with how far God has taken him. He's grateful to God. Okay. He has done very well.
As I said, it's not a campaign speech.
Yes, I'm laying the foundation. I'm laying the foundation.
Actually,
the point I'm trying to make is that
personal role.
Yeah, the point I'm trying to make is that government has a major role to play in the success of this election.
Because, you see, power in
the hands of desperate people, no matter how you plan the election, can be totally destroyed.
Mr. Okupe,
this president will not do that.
Let me repeat the question because I don't think you got it.
Okay, maybe, yeah. It's, I told you at the beginning there was issue of deafness.
Okay. Yeah.
So, let me hear you again.
Maybe I should talk in the other ear. What can you do in your position to promote a civil political discourse in the election period?
By creating a level playing field. By ensuring that the opposition is not molested or harassed in any way. And by being very accommodating, which has always been our disposition in all these matters. And by not being or not responding appropriately, effectively, to the over-desperation and the over-ambitious pursuit of power by the opposition. Yeah.
Okay.
That way, we believe that government will help.
One quick rebuttal there.
Thank you very much. I wish the president's spokesman could have put his right hand on his heart while saying those words. Thank God he is not saying this in secrecy. You've heard him, and he said they are going to allow level playing ground. If and when they do not do that, we are going to call on you to put that word right back to him. You promised us in Washington. Why have you deviated from this? All of you are going to be witness to the next election coming in Nigeria, and you are going to be our witness on that. But we have made up our mind that we are not going to allow anything lying low. We are going to stone every turn.
Not on every stone.
We are going to stone every turn made by them. Not to allow the votes of the people to count. Thank you very much.
Okay, let's open for some question and answer. We're going to take three questions at a time and then turn to one side, then the other. Okay, the gentleman here in the front. No, here, and then we'll come to you. And please identify yourself for the webcast.
Hi, Thank you very much. Welcome, you distinguished gentlemen from Nigeria. My name is Samuel Okembano. I'm the executive director of the Nigerian American Leadership Council right here in Washington, a nonpartisan independent organization. I got a few observations here, and it's great to see how the political process is evolving in Nigeria. I think one of the best things that has happened so far is the emergence of two strong political parties. This is actually something to celebrate. It's not something to fight about, though. It's something to celebrate, because when you win at this level, you win fairly, and you deserve a pat on your shoulders for that. Now, there's a question that Jennifer asked here on behalf of, I guess, all of us here that I never really get a response to, and that is the primary process. It's really very important that the primary process be paid attention to and be seen as free and fair, because if you cannot get the primary process within your own parties correctly executed, then you bringing up perhaps a flawed or a product of a flawed candidate into the space. Because the Nigerian American Leadership Council is totally nonpartisan, I'm not going to go into certain things. But in law, as a trained lawyer from Washington, D.C., there's something called the fruit of the poisonous tree. And if you end up with the fruit of a poisonous tree, then you've already started out with problems. And also,
I'm going to ask you to just wrap up.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Thank you.
And although it's a good point.
Yes, and then also the rhetorics, the decorum of the process. We'd like to see a lot more cordiality and decorum among the players than what we are seeing right now. We'd like to see the chieftains of PDP and the chieftains of APC go out for a drink after the usual hullabaloo and the fighting in the Senate and the House of Reps in Nigeria. So, all right, we would like to see much more of that, because I will tell you that there's a lot riding on this election. Nigeria must get this right. Anything that Nigeria does wrong embarrasses Nigerians, Nigerian Americans, and embarrasses all of Africa. So you have a lot of responsibility on your shoulders. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was excellent points and a comment from a very important US-based organization. We'll try to keep them a little more brief, though. The gentleman in the back there, and then we'll go here.
Gender.
Pardon?
Gender.
Oh, okay. We'll get to that, okay.
My name is Dr. Jonathan Obonna. I'm an adjunct professor of international security studies at Trinity Washington University. And I'm also a candidate for the PDP nomination for the Federal House of Representatives, isn't it? The Ayers of Federal Constituency. My question to Honorable Mohammed is party neutral. You cited some statistics that says 50% of Nigerians says that the president, that is President Jonathan Goodluck, is not doing a good job. 59% of Nigerians cited that he is not fighting corruption. My question to you is, are you trying to tell the audience that 50% of Nigerians, you know the population of Nigeria, right? That 50% of Nigerians, your survey conducted a survey on 50% of Nigerians and 59% of Nigerians. Or if that is not the case, what is your sample size that you use to extrapolate that 50% of Nigerians say something is wrong? Thank you.
Admonished on the gender thing. Well, let's the lady here, and then we're going to go to this section. And we'll take a first round of answers. No, the lady.
Good morning. My name is Tolu Odukoye. I'm a student of American University Washington College of Law, doing a master's in criminal law and international law. So my question is, I personally experienced the elections in 2000, and when did we have elections? 2011, I'm sorry. And I realized that after that, a lot of people went to court and did a lot of suits and said, these people didn't do this right and these people didn't do that right. So for the PDP, my question is, how inclusive are you? Because we've realized that as much as everyone wants to believe their party has the answer to every question, not everyone, you can't be an island. There are people in APC or the other parties who are also equipped to help Nigeria solve our problems. Our problem is not a one-party problem, it's a Nigerian problem. And you have people on the other side who are good enough to do this. So how much do you look outside your party partisanship to get people from the other side who could actually help you? And two, to the APC, how much are you willing to give up your partisanship to help them? Because you have people, but you might be keeping them because you think, oh, when we get power, we're going to be better and we're going to show the country that we could do this. We don't have that time. We're 50 years old. We need to move forward. So how long are you going to put that aside and start working together? Or 50-something, I'm sorry.
Thank you. Let's take that initial set. Well, we'll take one more because that was, in fact, a comment and then two questions. So I think here, Carl, you were going to be next, and then.
Hi, I'm Carl Levan from American University here in Washington, D.C. My question for the gentleman from the APC is, how do you see the state of emergency in three northeastern states affecting the political climate for campaigning in an open and free election? And as a related question to the presidential advisors, what steps do you see the Nigerian government taking to either discontinue or to ensure that that campaigning in places where the opposition has historically been strong, that there's a climate for peaceful exchange of ideas?
Sorry, I didn't get I didn't get that question properly. The one for the government.
The gist, as you say in Nigeria, is that the state of emergency in the Northeast, those three states, have traditionally been states that have been popular with the opposition to the PDP. And so there's a legal question and also a political question of how you will ensure that elections can take place with open and free competition from APC and others.
Professor Lai, we have a quick question on the sample size of the survey.
Yeah.
That's just a quick answer.
Yes, the survey was conducted by a professional firm, AKPD, and they interviewed 29,000. The poll conducted was in January. Sample size was 21,091 interviews across all 36 states, margin of error plus minus 1%.
Thank you. The question of kind of partisan, nonpartisanship and kind of using the expertise of the other. Would you like to tackle that?
Again, thank you very much. We realized this. And that was why, you know, when we were about to be formed, we, you know, consulted widely across the country. And that was why we were able to pick five governors of PDP who we know that, you know, in their intent and purposes, they can work with us. And they have good plans and programs and ideas to develop Nigeria. In the Senate, we went also after some of the senators, those who we know can collaborate with us for good governance, those with bright ideas, those with good intentions. We also brought in about 12 of their senators from PDP to join us. They are now members of APC. Of course, you're also aware of what happened in the House of Reps. So we've been doing all of this at the local level, at the level of young people. If you look at the outcome of the last election, a good number of young Nigerians invested hope in the candidate of the PDP. They campaigned on the internet, on Twitter. They were looking towards this man, with young person with, you know, PhD, who is going to turn Nigeria around. Today, the story is different. We are reaching out to those young people. They are going to come with us. They are going to vote for us. And we are going to ensure a bright future for them. Thank you.
But do you have to join the APC to work with your party ultimately in the government? I think that was part of the question.
Oh, that PDP to join with us?
How would you work with members of the PDP?
Yes.
Or do they have to switch parties before you work?
Well, there are still so many who believe in us who have not switched parties. We are working with them. We are leaving them there, learn their ways, let us know what is wrong with them, why they have not been able to turn Nigeria around.
Okay, thanks. All right.
I'll take that question on inclusivity. I think the senator obviously does not understand what bipartisanship means, really. That's the problem here. It's not a matter of APC joining PDP or PDP joining APC. The issue is that we've got a Nigerian problem. PDP, APC, at what point do you come together and see how to solve the problem? Am I correct, madam? Yeah, that's it. So, Mr. Senator, you got it wrong there. But that, the issue of inclusivity is crucial. You know, and it is failure of the elitist group in Nigeria that is the basis of this problem. The elites in Nigeria cannot even defend their interest. They have not been able to identify. They have not been able to identify what we can commonly refer to as national interest. You see, I'll give you a classical example. Let me just give an example. Just an example. One example.
30 seconds.
You know. In America, there are issues of race, et cetera, et cetera. But you will not see a Reverend Jackson go to Europe or Africa and condemn the United States. It never happens. It's not going to happen. But what do you find? You find the Bola Tinubus of this world, the El-Rufais of this world. Once they are pinched, they run to America, pick a rostrum, and condemn their own country. So, you know, how do you relate and work with such caliber of people? Okay. With time, we're going to get there, but it's going to take time. We will get there.
And we want to kind of stay off the ad hominem stuff, too. So. Okay. What was
the question on primaries. Primaries.
Oh, primaries, yes. And then.
On primaries, I'm sure that all people probably knows the importance of primaries because it's a charity begins at home. And we as a party, I think we have learned our lessons. We don't want to impose any candidate on anybody anytime again, because I'm sure that one of the problems we were having was these differences we're having in primaries, and we have sorted that out now. And when the most recent was talking about PDP going to APC, I'm sure we all knew what happened then. There were some differences, you know, those who were parochial, who were self-centered, because their own candidate emerged at our last convention. That's why they moved from the convention ground. That was what happened. And for those, they were about seven, but two knew that, they were making a mistake. They've come back to PDP. So I'm sure that even the rest who are there now, they know that the strange bedfellows, they'll come back. So they just saying that they are doing so well. I mean, that has nothing to do with our party. And one of the major problems that we have said that we impose candidates, and during the primaries, we ensured level playing ground for all aspirants. And of course, like I said earlier, we have a constitution, and if you want to contest for any elections, if you think you are qualified, you come out to convince the electorates, convince your party members that you are serious. And once you convince them, of course, then you go to for the primaries. And once it's leveled, of course, any candidate emerges, everybody will
rally around.
That's all. Like I said earlier on that, only in October here, I was an aspirant for the by-election in my state, the Delta Central. And of course, we went there. And one candidate emerged, and nobody even went to court. So what I'm trying to say is that we all know the importance of primaries. And most of the problem most parties are having is once they are not satisfied, they tend to move to other parties. We won't do that. We ensure that the ground is level for everybody. Anybody who wants to aspire for any office, you indicate your interest. And once you follow the due process and you emerge, of course, the party will follow you. So we're not going to impose any candidate. We have the rules are there. We have the laws are there already now. Once you confine yourself to that, that's all. So, and for the APC, Tango is not a national party now. So let's see let's see how it goes with their primaries. Let's see whether even those who are there now, whether they won't even move to other parties, because we know what happens in the APC, where leader picks their candidate.
Thank you. That kind of becomes the candidate
of the party. Thank you.
Primaries, quick word, and we'll try to keep questions and answers.
It always amuses me when people talk about internal democracy as if there's a one pill for all diseases. Internal democracy in any party must follow the constitution of that party and the guidelines of that party. In APC, we are proud of our tradition. They mistake our cohesion and our discipline for imposition. It's not so. We have a very robust internal democracy, and you can see what happened even on Saturday. We had the World Congress, where every registered member of the party queued behind a poster or the candidate of his or her choice. And that is the bedrock of democracy, because it's only the World Congress that is by direct election. It is those who are elected at that World Congress that will become delegates to local government congress and state congresses and national convention. In our party, we are very concerned about internal democracy, because a party that lacks internal democracy cannot give one when it comes into power. And there's even much more than that internal democracy. If you don't have a transparent, credible primaries, you are going to have a lot of disenchanted members who will not vote for you at the end of the day. So it's in the interest of our party or any party for its own self-survival to ensure that there is internal democracy. We want you to judge us by our constitution and by our congresses. But I can assure you that no party can survive in the long term without internal democracy.
Thank you. Okay, let's get to the question of the Northeast, which is a big uncertainty in these upcoming elections. We'll turn to this side first. Who would like to take that on?
Which one is that?
The question of the Northeast and the strategy for...
Well, on the Northeast, it's a major challenge. You know, here we have very serious insurgency activities. People are still being killed, bombs are still being thrown, and you know, anytime there is a gathering of people, it's a challenge. Even marketplaces are a danger point. So these are issues, you know, which I think the lady here was talking about on issue of bipartisanship. We cannot have all the answers alone. We've got to sit down and work this out with INEC, with APC, and what we're going to do. Because, you know, you're worried about security, you're worried about safety and lives of property. The insurgents are looking, you saw what happened, Afghanistan. The Taliban's, you know, promised that they're going to make it impossible for elections to take place. Thank God the election did take place, but even two journalists were killed. You know, so, you know, this, you know, we've got to, there's a delicate balance here. It's a non-partisan issue, and it is also a legal issue, like you rightly said, you know, that because the people there are entitled to take part and participate in the electoral process. But the government also has a responsibility to ensure that the people, while they're exercising their right, are safe. So, you know, these are issues that if I were to sit here and tell you, oh, I've got the answer, I would be fooling you and I would be lying to myself. The truth of the matter is that, you know, what our young lady has said here is what Nigerians must, you know, bring to fore. We've got to, on a bipartisan level, sit down and, you know, without sentiments, critically examine this matter and find a solution to it.
Thank you.
Well,
Senator.
Thank you very much. This is an area that is of special interest to me. I'm a member of the Committee for Defense and Army in the Senate, and I've taken a three-day tour of these affected zones, and I think I can speak with more authority on this than our brother, who sincerely, you know, they've not tried to even, you know, visit the place at all. Now, if you go to that place, it's a whole devastation. You have an entire town already destroyed. You have places, so many towns without schools any longer, without churches or mosques, without police posts. Local government councils have been destroyed and all of that. Yet, and I'm serious about this, and I know what I'm saying, a lot of what I know I cannot say at this forum for security reasons, but I know we have a major problem on our hand that call for all of us, all Nigerians, to come together and find a solution quickly. If we do not, I mean, I can hardly, I, you know, I can tell you that
it portends a lot of danger, not only for the Northeast, for the entire country. You must have heard of attacks in Benue, which is in the Middle Belt, in Nasarawa, in Katsina, in Samfara. For me, I'm seeing a trend, you know, that may, you know, in no long time, move to Kogi State, from there, maybe, God forbid, to my Ekiti State, or Ondo State, or Edo State. I think there is an agenda. What that agenda is, I don't know yet. We are still trying to figure it out. But thank God my brother is here. It calls for more seriousness than we are giving to it now. If this thing continues and moves as it is moving now, for God's sake, that election of next year may not be realistic. And we should ensure that election is realistic. Let us all work together. Let those who are holding power at the executive level, who are the commander-in-chief of the military in Nigeria, of the security forces, let them do more than they are doing now so that things can be better, you know, not only in that region, but across Nigeria. There are problems.
Mr. Mohammed.
Yes. Thank you very much. I said the issue of the insurgency in the Northeast, I think, is probably the single most serious challenge facing Nigeria today. And I think this is one area that the APC has offered not just suggestions and solutions, but has really told the government that this is not a matter that can be politicized. This is a matter where both the APC and the PDP and all the stakeholders should come together to address. Unfortunately, the government of the day has not distinguished between the message and the messenger. Now, incidentally, our three governors, that is Yobe, Borno, and Adamawa, are frontline states in the Northeast. They are the ones that actually feel the pinch of the insurgency. They are the ones that lose subjects every day. They are the ones whose economy is not working. They are the ones whose schools have been destroyed. They are the ones whose markets have been destroyed. Therefore, they are the number one and primary stakeholder in this issue. So when a governor from a frontline state, for instance, goes to Mr. President and complains out of desperation, he's not criticizing the government.
No, point of order, point of order.
The question was?
The question is, it's got to do with elections in the Northeast. If you want us to talk about Boko Haram, I am more than competent to do so. Alhaji Mohammed, point of order.
You can't talk about insurgency in the Northeast without talking about Boko Haram.
You
can't talk about the election. Excuse me, please. You can't talk about whether election will take place or not without actually talking about the recent death for the Boko Haram.
Okay.
Until and when you are able to address the real causes of Boko Haram, and you really are able to address the real solution, you will not only not stop elections from holding, you might even stop elections in the whole country from holding. What we are saying today is that what we have in the country today is what I call a strategic stalemate. And I believe that until and when we stop politicizing and factoring 2015 election into the way we address Boko Haram, for so long will there be no solution. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. 1 minute to Mr. Okupe.
Thank you, Jennifer. Basically, I said it before, this is not the conversation of the deaf. The question the gentleman asked was, how are we going to ensure that, in spite of the security challenges in the Northeast, that elections still take place? But because Lai Mohammed has gone beyond that.
Okay, no, you're not going to be able to go.
No, because he mentioned the advice to the president, and he also mentioned that a particular state governor came to the president and complained. That particular state governor did not know what he was talking about. He said that the Nigerian army was not competent and cannot contain Boko Haram, which was an absolute fallacy.
No.
It is wrong, it is untrue, and I do not expect you here and at this forum to raise such issues.
Okay.
It is nonsense.
Okay. This is one of the reasons, let's go to the gentleman in the front row there. Femi.
My name is Saad Farouk Mohammed. I'm from Zamfara State.
I feel the questions raised are clear enough to give one the opportunity to predict the reactions or the preparedness of every party as far as fairness and the maintenance of peace is concerned in the next coming election, 2015. We know the antecedents of PDP as far as internal democracy is concerned. I have experience of what happened in 2011 in my own state.
Keep this very short and make it a question.
So what I am trying to say is, why has PDP not said what it is doing internally as far as democracy is concerned in terms of incorporating or harmonizing the interests of those people that they are coercing at the moment within their folds? When we know that most of the crises that follow elections are generated based on dissatisfactions from lack of fairness by candidates.
Okay. Yes, the gentleman, yes.
I feel like I've won the lottery. Thank you. My name is Chime Sonye. I'm the executive director of Niger DC. We're a group of leading Nigerians connected to America's capital. When Nigerian thought leaders come to Washington, D.C., we love to talk to you guys to hear about the condition going on. We have a standing invitation for any of you if you want to talk to our group. And we've been doing that for a little bit now. My question is, I have a question for the PDP and for the APC. My first question for the PDP is to push back a little bit on the question of deaths. I actually think it's important to talk about certain types of deaths.
Deaths, people who died.
Okay. For instance, the young people who died in the stadium. And why I think it's important is because it seems to distinguish one party from the other. APC, for instance, moved to sanction the minister, et cetera, for the issue. And I didn't hear that from the other side. And young people and the role they play if they don't have jobs is very important in the elections. We saw what happened in 2011 with corpers being killed. We know that young people are the ones that go and snatch ballot boxes, et cetera. So whether young people have jobs is very important. In the last election, I'm a director of an organization, and we hosted the first ever youth-focused presidential debate. We didn't have President Goodluck Jonathan there, we would like. And so I would like to ask today if you guys would commit whoever was fielded to be part of our presidential debate if we ever hosted another one. And if that's not the case, I know President Goodluck Jonathan is fond of media chats. We would be more than happy to have a youth-focused presidential media chat. Often this happens with journalists, but I think one focus with young individuals would be great. My question to the APC individuals today, I don't really know how to distinguish APC and PDP. I understand that, you know, APC talks about themselves as vanguards of change and progress, et cetera, but when I look at it, all I've really seen out of APC outside of political institutionalization, i.e. voter registrars, et cetera, the overt political action I've seen is when you connected the idea of the budget, whether passes the budget would happen, to destabilization in Bayelsa. I don't know if you understand what I'm talking about. You said there was a crisis going on there and you would not pass any legislation unless that crisis was resolved.
Okay.
River States, thank you, River State. And my question to you, so that's, from my understanding, that's one of the biggest political actions I've seen outside of who you would field for candidates. And I was curious why you didn't use that opportunity to pass things like the national health budget, the electoral alliance. Why didn't you condition that on passage of an important piece of legislation for the Nigerian people versus the crisis that was going on in River State?
Thank you. Let's take one more. We have a lady here. Yeah.
Hi, Regina Campa. I work for a company named Seidel that provides technology for elections. And my question is regarding the diaspora. It's my understanding that they don't have a right to vote in these upcoming elections. We're talking about 17 million people. And if any of the political parties foresee any changes in the future elections.
And come back. So we had a pushback on the primary process. We had questions from the young man here. And
Well, I listened to him, really. Yeah. Well, you know, he was talking about fairness and, you know, why are we not making efforts to bring internal democracy. And I'm amazed because, I mean, you know, the Nigerian electorate are so politically, you know, differentiated to the extent that they have used and they retain the capacity to punish any party, you know, that fails, you know, within its own system to be just. It has happened in Lagos before. You know, a particular candidate, a particular primaries was killed and, was organized in the wrong way. The Lagosians said, okay, then it was AD or something in Abola Jobi time. NRC and SDP, yeah, NRC. Though the population, you know, mainly was SDP, but they decided to punish the party that was unjust and gave the victory to NRC. You know, at that time, the NRC did not really qualify for that. So, I want to assure this audience that, you know, in terms of internal democracy, there's no need for us to come here and banter and talk and all that. The Nigerian population, the voters are waiting to punish those who will be unjust. So, gentlemen, you don't need to worry about that. You will see it happen.
Well, then again, it's about the antecedent. Antecedent of PDP, yes. It's not about antecedent of PDP. I don't know. Which party are you in? Which antecedent are you talking about? Antecedent of PDP? Because the antecedent of PDP. I don't understand what you meant by that.
You don't need a mic for that.
Because I know.
Okay. What happened in 2011 was that they would impose a candidate for the party. They will insist.
Okay. But I'm sure that you have heard me.
Okay.
I'm sure you've heard me. I've said it repeatedly here that imposition of candidates won't happen in PDP. Again, I said it before now, and I also said too that if you recall what happened in our last convention. Some persons, once they are disgruntled, they are not satisfied with the way primaries are going, they leave the party. Like Malina Ali said, once primaries are not free and fair, of course we all know the consequences. And nobody's going to do that. We as a party, the biggest party in the whole of Africa, we were put our house in order. Like the new political party that just sprang up now. They're not a national party. Let's see how they will conduct their own your own primaries, and it works.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry, I think it is essential to emphasize that political parties are indeed very important in reviving democracy in any society. And I think looking critically at both parties, and be objectively now, I think where we have the problem actually is with the APC. The APC do not believe.
Okay, I'm going to cut you off there because we're running short of time, and I think
we have to work on that.
I don't think the mutual recriminations really serve the constructive dialogue here. So let's hear from Mr. Mohammed.
Thank you very much. I think the young man, you asked two questions. The first has to do with what is the difference between APC and PDP, and that to the best of your knowledge, the only thing you know about APC was when APC decided to direct its members in the National Assembly not to consider executive bills until and when the rule of law is restored in River States. Now, I think it's very important to give a short background to that. What happened was that we had an anomaly in River States. River State, as many of you will know, is one of the 36 states in the Federation. And there were some disagreements within the party, in the PDP, and especially between the president and the governor. And we noticed at that time that the commissioner of police in that state became the de facto governor. So we, on our part as a local party, we made representations, and I think both chambers of the National Assembly also went and conducted investigations, and they recommended that the police commissioner be removed. These recommendations were not heeded. Then it got to a point where lives and properties belonging to APC members in River States were not safe. So we directed our party in the National Assembly not to consider any executive bill until and when normalcy was returned to River States. Now, and I think this is a normal, you know, democratic, you know, tool. As to what is the difference between APC and PDP, I think this is exactly what we did on the 6th of March when we unveiled our roadmap to a new Nigeria, which is our manifesto. And if you go to www.anewnigeria.ng, you'll see our roadmap, which talks about what we're going to do when we win elections. It starts from job creation to fighting corruption to healthcare system to housing to security to agriculture to housing and to, you know, security and peace. So please, if you go to www.anewnigeria.ng, you will see exactly why we're different from the PDP. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank diaspora. You. On diaspora.
On diaspora. Again, let me say emphatically here that members of our party, particularly at the National Assembly, have been at the forefront of fighting for the rights of the diaspora to vote. The bill for that was proposed by Honorable Abike Dabiri of APC in the House of Representatives, and we have been campaigning. Our party have been fighting for that. Again, as we said, we have our say, they have their way. But I can assure you, by next year, where we are in the majority, when we are in the majority, we are going to pass this bill, because it is very important. If you know the relationship between the diaspora and the people at home, you will know that, look, they are sacrificing a lot for the betterment of our society. Many are going to school today because of the money they receive from diasporas. Many are surviving today. You know, a good number of good things are being done by this. They are enlightened. There are thousands of Nigerian professors abroad, hundreds of medical doctors abroad. You know, with their input, Nigeria will become a better place. They are well informed. They've seen it all out there. Nobody can buy their vote with 1,000 naira. You know, so, and I believe that if they are allowed to vote, it's going to make a big difference. That is why the majority is sitting on that and not allowing it to happen.
No. Most distributed, I don't understand. Each time a bill is not passed, it's PDP.
Okay.
Why are you always saying so?
I'd like to hear what the PDP position on diaspora voting is.
Well, let me help the senator. The diaspora organizations and members are people that, I'm not talking about PDP, that, you know, President Jonathan and this government take very seriously. You will see that there's a lot of inclusion of members of the diaspora, even in the cabinet, and they're doing very, very well. Aganga is one of them. Okojo Nwala himself is one of them. Adishino is one of them.
And in terms of voting.
Now, I'm coming to that. And also, when we have a group of Nigerians who are, through their efforts and their sweat and their labor, are able to remit in the excess of $32 billion a year into the Nigerian economy, we got to take them serious. Mm-hmm. The problem we have, you know, and this is the problem of Nigeria, this is not a partisan issue. And Senator, you know that better than anybody else. Just hold on, sir. What is stopping the diaspora from voting is not any law. It is the question of practicability. The people who are in Nigeria presently and are unable to vote effectively and for their votes to be counted. So we have issues with that, and we're still working with that. Not to talk of, I mean, Nigerians are virtually everywhere in the world. I see this lady say that, you know, she works for a technological company, you know, that helps. These are the kind of things that will, you know, when these type of things are, you know, you are requesting for biometrics, you know, voting pattern, and we have not even been able to, you know, we should be there. That is, you know, Ghana is already voting using biometrics. You know, so Nigeria also should be there. But, you know, we've got to take it as one step at the other, you know, within the shortest possible time. It's not a matter of legal framework. The diaspora will inevitably be part of the democratic process in Nigeria. I can give you that on very good authority.
Thank you. Okay. We are at time. I want to ask one final 2-minute or 3-minute question to each side, and then we're going to turn to Ambassador Adefuye, who wanted to say something very brief to wrap things up. Because we're here in Washington, we want to hear from both sides kind of your final message today to a U.S. audience and your priority questions, and I hope you'll be specific and brief in terms of what you would look for from the United States government in supporting peaceful, credible elections in 2015. Why don't we start with Lai Mohammed?
What is our message today?
And what is it that you would like from the United States government in terms of support?
Thank you. There's no doubt that Nigeria, as Nigeria inches towards the 2015 elections, all eyes on Africa's most populous nation. While many see these elections as a watershed and an opportunity for the country to turn the corner and get its elections right, others, including many people in this country, are skeptical and doubtful about the conduct and transparency of the elections. If history is anything to go by, Nigeria has hardly come close to holding free and fair elections. If we move so away from the quality of elections and integrity of the process that was achieved during the June 12, 1993 election. Since that time, what we've had, our experience has been election after election, has been systematic and near criminal manipulation of the election process. In most instances, the brazen writing of election results took center stage. Sweet ladies and gentlemen, Nigeria today stands at its crossroads. The direction it turns with regard to the conduct of the 2015 elections will determine whether democracy survives or remains perpetually threatened. On behalf of my party, the APC, I would like to thank our friends at the Center for Strategic and International Studies for their invaluable efforts to contribute to the success of our forthcoming elections. We would ask that the US and all foreign nations that are friendly to this country and believe in democracy should insist on the process not being flawed, rather than the outcome. It is the interest of the whole of democratic world that we get it right this time. Elections are not rigged only on election days. It is the process that leads to election day that are so crucial. And I'm happy that we both agreed on one issue, that is a credible voters register. If the voter has no access to cast his vote, that election will be flawed. And the experience we had in Anambra State, where we had a different sort of register given to political parties and a different one on election day, where most people ran around, they could not even find their names. A situation where even the chairman of the commission had to admit that, yes, one of his officials was induced with money to disenfranchise thousands of people, where registers are so manipulated that names starting with a particular alphabet removed from the register will not make for a free and fair election. We are not asking for much. We are only asking that let there be a voter's register which is credible, let people be able to vote and let their votes count. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Jennifer, very distinguished ladies and gentlemen, it's been a great and wonderful opportunity for me as a person and representing the President of Nigeria to participate at this occasion. And I'm also deeply, moved and, gratified by the fact that there are people outside Nigeria who are very much interested in the welfare and well-being of Nigeria, because if we do not get the process of electioneering properly and, regularly done well, it will be difficult for us to join the rest of the world. And for this, CSIS, we thank you immensely. And you distinguished gentlemen and ladies here, I also extend my gratitude. I want to assure you, and I'm not being partisan here, and I'm also not campaigning, this is the truth. The man at the helm of affairs presently is a man that is committed to rebuilding Nigeria, and he agrees and he recognizes that the starting block of this is by having a credible, free, and fair election. He has distanced himself and he has resisted party pressures to intervene in elections that have taken place since he became president and to ensure that the will of the people are not thwarted. And I'm talking seriously, and you know, these are facts. You know, there are many elections that have taken place, both by elections and state elections, where PDP, under the watch of President Goodluck Jonathan, you know, has lost elections. And he has refused to participate, he has refused to influence, he has refused to influence anything. On his debut in 2011, he said, and I quote, My victory is not worth the life of any Nigerian, and that nobody should do anything in terms of violence in order to assist him. And he promised Nigerians that the election will be free and fair, and you know, to the best of my knowledge and to the best that I have heard from the observers, international observers, it was adjudged as one of the best elections ever. I will be the first to admit here that we are not there yet. We are not, and we cannot be there yet. You know, we've had, you know, a checkered history, you know, with military background, military interregnum, you know, alternating with civilian administration and all that. You know, we are not there yet. But, you know, where there is a will, always there is a way. And there's a commitment from this present government that there will be a will. You know, this government will ensure, when Professor Jega was appointed as the chairman of the Electoral Commission, the president came to the public and said he has never, ever met Jega before. This is not what a desperate politician will do. He has never seen him. He has never had a relationship with him. He asked for people to give me a list of credible Nigerians that can fit this bill. And out of that lot, you know, they picked this gentleman. And he immediately instituted him as chairman.
Mr. Okupe, so, in one minute, the U.S. role.
Thank you very much. We are going to continue to improve on the electoral process. We are going to try to continue to improve on it, give the support that is necessary to the electoral body to ensure that they perform their job very well. For the United States of America, a good friend, a great friend of Nigeria, it gives me, you know, great pleasure to stand on this soil to talk about another great nation, Nigeria. You know, our destinies are linked. You know, we are today what America is to the world is what Nigeria is to Africa. And of recent, you have just heard, Nigeria has been declared and, you know, has been recognized as the largest economy in Africa. And I know that the United States of America is one of our largest traders. So, you know, we have a destiny that is interlinked, and I'm not surprised that you're interested in our well-being. What we will need is in the area that you are evidently superbly much ahead of us, in areas of data collection, data processing. It is so important for us to get assistance from the U.S. in the area of building up a credible voter register. And I think you are quintessentially qualified to give this assistance. This is a major support that we will desire, because that will create a major level playing field so that everybody in Nigeria can be comfortable. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I thank you very much. God bless you.
Maybe just a very brief final comment.
Jennifer, I'm sorry it will not be as brief as you say, because these are...
Please, I
will try.
Please, please.
No, I will try. This is the main reason why I'm here, and I really do have to put a few things in perspective.
Well, I will try
to be brief. Just, I want to direct my intervention, my conclusions to three sets of people. First, to CSIS. Let me say we thank you most sincerely for this meeting. And you in particular, I don't envy you for moderating this debate. And I can understand why you said, when there's a debate, you would not like to be the moderator. The thing is that What this meeting has shown is the vibrancy of we Nigerians. And I really want to thank you for that. But one thing, the topic was about the elections 2015. And the only omission I thought, I know Jega was here some weeks ago, but I would have thought that there's somebody from INEC here to respond to a few of the questions thrown at INEC. That's number one. Number two, I do know Jega as a person. And I knew his background. And what Doyin said about the way he was selected, he was appointed, very correct. And I know him, and I, as a person, have observed elections. When I was the director of Africa in the Commonwealth, I've observed 35 elections in 15 countries. The 2011 elections in Nigeria was ranked among one of the best conducted. And I must say, you may disagree with me, but we had a seminar here in which all the participants, all the election observers from here were there, and that was 2 days after the presidential election. They were here, and they testified to that.
Okay.
That, and including people from CSN. I'm coming, please.
It's meant to be a final wrap-up.
Yeah, I'm
comment.
Coming. Also, what this has done, has demonstrated to our friends here, is that I know the Anambra election was flawed, but the embassy and the Nigerian government, through with the U.S., we are making efforts to ensure that the voter register is put in place and that we satisfy all Nigerians. And to our American friends, I will say this. You've seen the vibrancy of Nigerians. We are committed to a free, fair, and credible election. Whatever happens, all those armchair critics who see an end to a possible end to Nigeria by end of 2015, those pundits who are in Nigeria for 2 weeks and come back to be experts on Nigeria, we have gone through a lot. We've gone through civil wars. We've gone through military coups. We even had to invoke the doctrine of necessity one time or the other. But we are determined to have a Nigeria that is democratic, that is stable and secure. I can assure you, we are going to have 2015 elections. There'll be protests, there'll be court cases. By the end of it, Nigeria will survive.
Okay.
We shall survive
as
a country.
Thank you very much. That's a great note
finally, let me say this, please. Let me say this, a sentence. I enjoyed this discussion. It wasn't as heated or controversial as I thought. And those who are contributed, I congratulate you for the way you have handled it. The only thing I just want to say, that next time, let us restrict ourselves to the questions. Do not let us come and watch our linen in public. Campaigns are meant to be conducted in Abuja, and I'm saying this to both sides. Not in Washington, not anywhere in America. The debates on what is happening, those contentious issues, should be limited to our country, not here. The embassy will resist, and I'm saying with all the forces at my command, the embassies will resist any attempt to make America a campaign ground for Nigerian elections. We are going to resist that. Talk issues, but I'm talking to both parties. Go and discuss your campaign in Abuja and other cities. Don't come here and have political bickerings, counter-allegations, exposing our leanings to the public before the Americans.
Okay.
Let us, patriotic professionals, don't do that, and I will not sit here and
Ambassador,
see that being done.
Ambassador,
thank you.
Thank you. Just, I want to say thank you to our panel once again. A lively debate. We love dirty laundry washed in public. So we hope we'll stay in touch. I'm glad that you're the possibility of a joint statement, a code of conduct, a lot of agreement on the voter registers, the Electoral Offenses Act,
and a debate.
So we'll look forward to this, and thank you all for being patient and joining us today.
Thank you.
Thanks.